You know, it's funny. I got an email from Tony Levin. Do you know who Tony Levin?
Oh, he's a famous cat.
Very famous bass player. Yeah. Okay. Plays with Peter Gabriel. Mm-hmm. The bald guy.
Okay.
I got a message from him last night. Who said that? He said he was in Woodstock at a party, a big party in Woodstock, and he runs into this girl, Julie Last, who was one of my assistants on Double Fantasy, hadn't seen since then, but she lives in Woodstock. So he's like, wow, that's really odd that I should run into her. And then he looks over, and there was a bar there, and sitting at the bar was Hugh McCracken, who played on the record, was the guitar player in that band.
Wow.
Also the guitar
strange
player
synchronicities,
in Wings.
Huh?
Yeah.
Whoa.
He was also the guitar player in Wings. So
wow.
He and the original, Wings.
Okay.
He didn't join the band. He would leave to New York. You know, he wouldn't go to Scotland.
I see.
Paul asked him, "Oh, you got to be in the band." He said,
yeah.
"Only if you stay in New York."
Can we move on to another band that we're all quite fond of, Cheap Trick?
Oh, God. I don't know how much you know, but, I signed them to
Epic. We know you were there at the most important records from a fan's perspective, I say.
Oh,
but I didn't know about
the
that.
The first one in Budokan, I think.
Yeah.
But I signed them.
Wow.
I was visiting a relative in Waukesha, Wisconsin.
Okay.
In the middle of nowhere. And this guy said to me, you got to come down to the bowling alley and hear this band play. And I went down to the Sunset Bowl. And I'll never forget this place. A bowling alley. They had a lounge. And the place was packed to the rafters.
Wow.
And the band was Cheap Trick. And they did like a show that was part carnival, part circus, part rock and roll show. It was amazing. And I was knocked out by it. And I called up Tom Werman the next day, and I said, if you don't get out here this weekend to Waukesha, Wisconsin, I'll bring this band to RCA.
Wow.
And Tom was head of A&R at Epic, and he came out, and he loved the band. Mm-hmm. And he came out and heard it, and we offered them a deal, and we were in the studio, I think, in a month.
Wow. So you discovered them?
Yeah, I discovered them. Well, a lot of people in the Midwest
had already
discovered
them.
Yeah, they were very popular, but they weren't signed.
Wow.
And,
what about the music were you originally attracted to or inspired by?
I thought it sounded something like the Beatles.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. It had that same kind of organic quality to it.
Mm-hmm.
And a great singer. And
yeah.
Just, and they were unique. You know, it was like a Beatle copy band. Just
right.
And it wasn't that they sounded like the Beatles. They just had the same kind of uniqueness and organic. Something
similar character, something their character was adjacent to the Beatles.
Yeah, but I mean, each individual in the band was different.
Sure.
Two kind of pretty boys, and one guy. The drummer looked like an accountant, and the guitar player looked like a nut.
Yeah, a nut.
So it all kind of worked in a strange way. You know, last summer, not this past summer, but the summer before. I got to revisit Budokan.
Oh.
And because they found the video of that show, the actual video.
Okay. The master copy.
Yeah, the master copy was found in Japan.
Yeah.
And Jay Messina and I went back in and remixed everything to picture.
Mm-hmm.
You want to check that out. And you can see those shows now, those Budokan shows.
Uh-huh.
And we mixed it in 5-1. It's pretty. It's pretty darn exciting, I must say.
Wow.
It's very
takes
cool.
You there. Takes
oh, you're
back.
There. Yeah, yeah.
Hey, that's just a ringer.
And when we were doing this Budokan album, we were all working together.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
doing overdubs or anything like that?
No, no overdubs.
Nothing like that. Right?
No
okay.
Overdubs. None whatsoever.
But they were all collectively there.
Yeah, they would come by the studio in New York and check it out and. And we stay really close. I mean, the guys in Aerosmith and the guys in Cheap Trick, we're pretty much a big family.
Yeah.
We stay very close. We talk all the time.
Aerosmith's going through a lot of different changes, and there's controversy about them, about Steven Tyler being in the band, and there's all this controversy right now. Do you know anything about what's going on with Aerosmith?
I think Wednesday they're all meeting.
Good.
In Boston.
Good.
I was talking to Brad Whitford yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a possibility there's one more record has to be done.
Okay.
But we're talking. So, you know.
Well, I hope that things settle down.
There's a lot of mess right now.
Yeah.
There's a lot of sorting out to do, but mm-hmm. But you know, everyone's getting a little more clear-headed, right, at this point, and I mm-hmm. think, you know, whether I do the record or not, I mean, the record has to be done.
Sure.
And the tour has to be completed.
Yeah.
And then after one more record, well, like, you know, I'll go their merry way, but I think they'd like to make a good statement on the way out.
I hope so.
Yeah, a good old rock and roll record.
Absolutely. So you stay in touch with all those people?
Yeah, I talk to every one of them.
Wow, that's cool.
On a regular basis.
Awesome.
Again, that's family. You look at the how many records there were and all the years that we've worked together. So it's it's like really is a family.
Sure. You've been there at some of the most important times of their lives, you know, making their dreams happen.
Yeah, well, it goes further than that, too.
Yeah, I'm sure it does.
We help each other in numerous ways.
I see. That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. Wow, you really are a legend.
No, I'm not a legend at all. Look, I'm right here.
You're right here.
There's a legend that I exist. Well, here I am. We're doing this thing, Show a Piece, with Jimmy Page. And it's either April 17th or sometime in September. That's up to the Chinese government. They wanted April 17th, but it might be a little difficult to pull it all together, right? And it's like coming right down, but you can check it out online and it will be happening.
Well, that sounds big.
It's huge.
Cool, this in China too.
It's huge.
Yeah, bringing China the rock.
And watch for the Double Fantasy.
Yeah, that sounds
watch
exciting.
For Tender Pucks.
Yeah, is this the new artist you're working with?
Yes,
now?
It is.
Do you want to mention anything about them?
They have a pretty much of a following here in LA, but we're getting ready to do their first major album.
Cool.
We're mixing some of them right
what
now.
What label is this one for?
It's for Phil's label here at Swing House.
Oh, Swing House.
Yeah.
Nice.
But if it might go somewhere else, we can't talk about it yet.
Yeah.
You know, I still do like tons of stuff. I do projects for free if I like them.
Oh, yeah?
I'll do projects for, you know, $1 million if I like them. I won't do anything I don't like.
That's a good place to be.
Just having a blast, you know.
Yeah.
I wake up in the morning, I teach.
Oh, yeah, in San Francisco?
Yeah, I teach at a digital arts college. I teach the psychology of the recording session.
Oh, wow,
it's a media
that sounds
psychology
interesting.
Course. Yeah, you know, just having fun.
And like you said, you have to keep it popping, keep different things happening.
Yeah, like you got to, you know, it keeps you in shape.
Yeah.
Well, the gym helps, but I mean, you got, I'm watching your diet, but I mean, you got to, stay in the studio. It's like, so Bob Dylan says, stay on the bus.
Right.
Just keep touring.
When you
touring.
Get off the bus, you lose that inertia, right?
Just keep touring as much as you can.
That makes sense. Well, we wish you the greatest luck.
Okay,
all
thank you very much.
In the future.
Thanks for coming by.
Thank you,
John. Good night.